Here, let's read John chapter 3, verse 3 through 19. And this is where we left off a couple weeks ago. It says, Jesus answered and said to him, remember this is Nicodemus, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered him and said, how can these things be? Jesus answered him and said, are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended to heaven but he who come down from heaven, that is the Son of Man who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is a condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come into the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. I believe I was actually going to stop at 19. But, you know, for the past 4 weeks, I've been out. And, wow, you know, from Pennsylvania, whenever I had a chance, I would listen to the sermons. I only got to I got to watch Scott preach last week, and I got to watch Roy preach live over the internet. And I missed Steve and David live, but I've listened to their sermons twice since. You know, if you guys ever want to recap, they're all online. They're all on YouTube. They're going to be on our website. We were talking this morning, if anyone wants an audio version, we have that. We can burn you a CD or something like that. But see, these guys did a wonderful job. Roy was talking about false Christs and false teachers. And David Goodell, among other things. And David was talking about discernment and testing and comparing that to survival school. Y'all remember that, how you would taste something and see if it's, if it's good, you know, if you taste poison ivy and your face starts to rash up, you know, that's bad. You don't want to eat that. He was saying we do that with the things out there in the world. We, you know, in different doctrines, we test these things, you know. And Stephen King was talking about the true believers in our responsibility to bear fruit and other things. And Scott last week was a double-minded man. But out of all these sermons, you know what stood out the most? Every time that someone was getting ready to preach, they said, every single time that I can remember, they said, wow, that devotion does go with my sermon. They did. And you know what I'm saying this morning? Roy, thank you for fighting that, because wow, that devotion does go with my sermon. That was awesome. Roy gave a devotion this morning. If you missed it or need a recap, it says God is in control. It's Psalm 139, 15 and 16. And it was saying how God knew David in the womb. And he knew his days before he was even born or before he even came about. And Roy's like, yes, it's just like me, Roy. I see this stuff all over the place now. And you know, sometimes you try to avoid it because you're like, wow, I sound like a broken record. But here is God. He's in control, and he is powerful, and he is sovereign. And here's the thing. If you truly know yourself and know how sinful you are, you'll eventually see that as a good thing. And that's how we should look at that, as a good thing, because God can save me from those sins. God can help and break that bond. Remember, the word says we're in bondage to sin. Those that we love sin and we love darkness, until we have the Spirit of God in us changing us to love the light. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about a little bit of that today. Chapter 3 of John is so important. Chapter 3 of John, there's at least 8 major Christian doctrines in chapter 3 of John. And the difficulty for me is I jump all over the place. And I'm trying not to jump from doctrine to doctrine and show you this and that, because it's everywhere. I mean, there's so much stuff in John chapter 3. But it's all summed up in John 3:16. Everyone knows John 3:16. It's probably the verse that every single Christian knows. And a lot of non-believers know John 3:16. It is almost a sum of the entire Christian gospel. Sad part is sometimes it's misused, abused, and wrongly quoted. Because you just throw out John 3:16. Well, there's verses before John 3:16. There's verses after John 3:16. And when you really come down and look at John 3:16, there's some difficult things. And there's beautiful things there. I mean, there's God. For God so loved the world. The world. What is the world? Man. Look at the Bible when it talks about the world. The world is at enmity with God. But yet God loved the world. And he sent, who sent? God sent his only begotten Son. See, a lot of times in Scripture we'll look at Jesus as a good one, God as a mean one, and Jesus saving us from God, which is true that Jesus saves us from God, the wrath of God. But who sent Jesus to begin with? God. God sent Jesus to save us. So there's that doctrine. I mean, there's all this in John 3:6. What did he save us from? What did he give us? Eternal life. You see, that whosoever believed in him should not what? Perish. So we got the perish doctrine in there. That we have, that if we don't have belief in Christ, we are perishing. But then the other doctrine, if we believe in Christ, we have eternal life. But then I'll ask you, what is believing in Christ? Because it says in James, or somewhere, I think it's James, even the demons believe. Okay? So what is believing in Christ? And we'll go over a little bit of that. But when you look at John 3:16, here's the problem. What we try to do today is we try to bring ourselves into this. We try to bring our works into this. Our the things that we can do, we try to bring that into this salvation equation. And that is wrong. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Now, then it says, whosoever believeth, there's a requirement to believe. But there's a whosoever's a believe and a whosoever's a don't believe. So we got another difficult subject there. The very first word, and here's what I plan to do. We've got, there's a lot in John chapter 3. It would be a travesty to just gloss over John chapter 3. There's so much there. We're not going to spend years on John chapter 3. We could. I know I've heard of a preacher that preached on John 3:16 over and over and over again. But we're not going to spend years on it. But what we're going to do is we're going to use John 3:16 for the fulcrum. John 3:16 is the center point of John chapter 3. There's words before John 3:16 and there's words after John 3:16. And the center point, the balance point, is John 3:16. See, John 3:16 starts out with the little word, for. Well, you can't ignore that word, because for means, and we've learned this in Romans, the stuff he said before is a conclusion up to John 3:16. So everything he said from John 3:3, or even prior to that, a little bit prior to that, concludes or sums up in John 3:16. That little word for. And then God so loved the world. What degree of love did God love the world? I mean, how deep did God love the world? There is the doctrine of his only begotten Son. The Trinity. You see the Trinity in chapter 3. You see the Holy Spirit. You see the only begotten Son, and you see God. All three of them in John chapter 3. See, verse 17 says that he sent his Son. Verse 16 said that he gave his Son. Verse 17 said that he sent his Son. It's repeated. Who? God. And then here's the other thing. The whosoever. Whosoever is whosoever. There's no limits on it. It's not whosoever. If you're rich. Whosoever if you're poor. No, it's whosoever. Whosoever, if you're Jewish, no. Whosoever believes in him shall not perish. Okay? Any nation, any language, any tribe, any tongue, any person, whosoever believes in Jesus shall not perish but have eternal life. Whosoever. That is a hopeful verse. So, but let's go to the word for. What is for summing up? For, God so loved the world. For, it says summing up the prior verses. Well, he's talking to Nicodemus, right? And he says to Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He cannot see the kingdom of God. So what's that tell you? Unless you're born again, none of this, you don't care about any of this stuff I'm talking about. You cannot see it. You can hear it, but it doesn't sink in. It also says, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Because if you look at after John 3:16, it says here, and this is the judgment, verse 19, the light has come into the world and people love darkness rather than light because their works were evil. Without that light coming into your life, you're not going to see it. 1 Corinthians. See, it also says earlier, it says flesh is flesh and spirit is spirit, verse chapter 3, verse 6, it says, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Here's the thing. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. And we're talking about John 3:16. Whosoever shall believe. The natural person does not accept the things of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. In our human nature, and Scott talked about this, in our human nature, if you read John chapter 1 and John chapter 2 and the rest of the Bible, you'll see that our human nature desires the things of the world, not the things of God. It is God that reaches out and touches our heart and changes and inclines our heart to him and his ways. His Spirit that touches our heart and inclines us to him. Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, for the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. Scott talked about this last week, about being, we still have flesh, but now we have the Spirit of God residing in us. And we have this war going on. But see, Jesus said to Nicodemus, the flesh is the flesh, and the Spirit is the Spirit. He's telling Nicodemus to see the kingdom of God, to enter the kingdom of God, you have to be born again. And this term, born again, also means to be born from above. Look in the later verses. It can mean both, to be born from above. It's a play on words in the Greek. Okay? Now here, in 3:5, he says, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter. What does the word water mean? What does the word water? See, we normally, sometimes today, we'll look at this and say it means baptism. Unless you're baptized, you can't get to heaven. That's not the case. We are commanded to be baptized. Baptism is a work. Baptism is something we do after we're born again. Okay? But it doesn't, it's not like that ticket to get to heaven. That's why that some of the churches baptize their babies. Because if something happened to their babies, they want to make sure they got that ticket to get into heaven. It's not it. What does John 3:16 say? To believe. It's talking about believing. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not preaching against baptism. I think every single Christian should be baptized because Jesus tells us to baptize. And it's a statement of faith. It's a symbol of us dying, being resurrected. It's a symbol of cleansing. It's a symbol of things. But right here at this time in John chapter 3, baptism's not being talked about. It's talked about the water and the Spirit. What is the water? And you say, well, water always means baptism. No, it doesn't always mean that. It can be a symbol of that. But look, he tells Nicodemus, he says, are you not the teacher of Israel, and do you not understand these things? See, Nicodemus should know what he's talking about. Well, the book of Acts, where all the baptisms occurred, has not even been written yet. It wasn't even played out yet. But he's telling Nicodemus, as a teacher of Israel, you should know what I'm talking about. So the answer to the word water has to be found in the Old Testament. Now, look at Ezekiel chapter 36, 24 through 27. Let's take a look there. What I'm trying to tell you is, you are not saved by works. You are saved by the hand of God. You are not saved by works. I'm not discouraging anyone against baptism. I'm saying when you become saved, you're saved by God, not by what you've done. You're saved by God. In Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 24 through 27 says this, this is God, I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you. There you go. There's the water. And you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. Let me tell you something. There's not enough water. There's not enough soap. There's not enough borax in this world to clean you. It's God that cleans you. Okay? You can't clean yourself. And that's what I'm preaching against. I'm preaching against your works trying to earn your way into heaven. Okay? It says, verse 26, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit, and I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit, I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. I will do this. That's God speaking. That's God speaking. You see, you have to get to the point where you're like, wow, I can't do this. And you call out to God for help because the weight of your sin is unbearable. You can't fix it on your own. You need Jesus. You need to believe in His death, in His resurrection for your salvation, not the things that you can do. Now, the Word of God is clear. We are to do. We are to provide fruit. We are to produce fruit. But none of that depends on your salvation. That is after salvation. That is, there's a term, regeneration, where you're born, where it says, we plant the seed, right? We plant the gospel. Who makes it grow? God makes it grow. Okay? We may cultivate it. We may water it. We may tend it. But God makes it grow. God does. So, if we say, and we can do it. I've seen, you got steps to salvation. Maybe some steps to salvation. And let me say this. Baptism is very important. Because in the Word of God, go ahead and put up this picture, Sean. There should be a picture. Okay. Steps to salvation. It says God's part. God sent His Son. Jesus shed His blood. And the Spirit revealed the Word. Now here it says man's part. Now in a way this is true because we are being saved right now. Until we get to heaven, we are being saved. But in a sense, it's not true because we are already saved. Because God speaks in it as past tense. I saved you. And then other times it says you are being saved. But here's the thing. Hear the word, believe, repent, confess, baptize, and remain faithful. Well, remain faithful. Good luck on that on your own because it says man's part. You can't do that. Okay? All these things are part of this stairwell, okay? But the problem I have is with the man's part. You can't do it. You got to have God. And the problem is we go about this backwards. We will try to remain faithful. We will get baptized. We'll confess our sins. We don't include God until the end. We go backwards on the staircase. You see? And we can't do that. See, if you don't have the true belief, true trust and faith in Jesus Christ, I don't care what you've done. Your baptism, it's no good. You've got to have true trust and faith in Jesus Christ. Not yourself. Not your works. See, it says in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, it says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God. Not a result of works that no one may boast. No one may boast. See, in Acts chapter 16, verse 30, this question was asked. On that picture it said, what must I do to be saved? Here's the answer. Acts chapter 16 through 30 and 31, it says, and he brought them out and said, sir, what must I do to be saved? Verse 31 says, and they said, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. The next verse says they shared the word of God with him and then they all went and became baptized. But when he said, what must I do to be saved? He said, believe. That doesn't mean that you believe in nothing. You believe in Jesus. Well, what do you believe? Why do you need Jesus? See, we live in a day and time that puts more emphasis on man's work than God's work. And that's all I'm trying to say, is that your work is important. But without God's work, your work would count as filthy rags, like the Bible says. We live in a day where we exalt our work and we don't recognize God's work. We want to avoid God's work because it's a difficult subject. See, you basically got four kinds of people. You got some believe. And when I mean believe, when I say believe, they believe. They're not trusting in themselves. They're not trusting in their works. They're doing the things that God told them to do, but they believe. And here's the thing about doing works. James said it right. He said, if you have faith, and I'm paraphrasing, if he says you have faith and don't have works, then your faith is dead. Okay? So when I'm saying you believe and you produce works, but your works do not save you. It would be contrary to the verse we just read where it says works do not save. What James is saying is the faith, the belief that's required to believe in Jesus Christ produces works. That type of faith produces works. Now, some believe. And then some say they believe. And this is a dangerous category. Some say they believe, but really trust in themselves. That's a dangerous category to be in. And that's those people are in the church, in the pews, and this is very prevalent today. Very prevalent today because we trust in our own works. We do a mission trip or we do this or we do that. And then it's like the old question. When you get to heaven and God asks you, why should I let you in? This is a great witnessing tool. You walk up to somebody and say, hey, when you get to heaven and God asks you why I should let you in, if they say anything other than Jesus Christ or his work or his salvation or what he's done for me, then the answer's wrong. Because if you stand there and you say, well, I was a deacon, I was a pastor, I ran the drums, I did this, I did that, I did this, I did that, that's your works. That gets you nowhere. You say it was Jesus Christ, and on his merit and his authority alone can I stand before God. Other than that, I can't be before God without Jesus Christ. So that's a dangerous category because some believe in their works, not God. But then you've got other people that are indifferent. They really don't think much about it, okay? Down deep they do. And then you got people in the world that are just totally opposed to God. And of course, unless they change their ways, we know where they're going. But to be in that gray area where you're actually in a church, but you really don't trust on Jesus, is kind of dangerous. Because you could have this false sense of security that really is not there. Because really it's Jesus Christ's work that gets me into heaven and cleanses me and purifies me. So in John 3:16, it says that whoever believes in him, not in this or that act that he's commanded us to do, but not in acts that he's commanded us to do, because it says, not by works will you be saved, but it says that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Whoever believes in him. But what is the consequence for not believing in him? Perishment. You say, whoever believes in him shall not perish. Well, then it stands to reason that whoever does not believe in him will perish. So there was a difficult doctrine right here in John 3:16. See, Psalms 49, 7 through 15, this is in my reading this week. It says, truly no man can ransom another or give to God the price of his life. For the ransom of their life is costly and can never suffice, that he should live on forever and never see the pit. Then skip down to verse 15. It says, but God will ransom my soul from the power of Sheol, for he will receive me. God does. God does ransom me. See, it basically says here, you don't have enough money to pay the price. You don't have the required price to pay. Jesus does. And he paid it. So that is a beautiful part of the verse. Because see, God so loved, God so cleansed. He cleansed. He removed the heart of stone. He gives you a heart of flesh, and it's all God. I will do this. And all I'm telling you this morning is believe in God and not yourselves. Believe in God and not yourselves. See, John 3:16, it says, whosoever believes. Well, let me tell you this. This is very clear. And you can argue with it as much as you want. But the Word of God is clear. Turn to John chapter 10, verse 26. John chapter 10, verse 26. This is out of the mouth of Jesus. This statement right here and some others, just like it caused them to pick up stones and want to stone Jesus. This statement and others like it caused them to crucify Jesus. Whosoever believes. Well, what about the one, the whosoever who does not believe? It says right here, it says 10:26, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. They will never perish, and none will snatch them out of my hand. Once again, it's God. It's the sovereignty of God. Oh, I know, we're not robots, man. We do and choose and please, and we do as we please. The problem is that before the Spirit of God enlightens our heart, we our mind is bent on the things of the world. We don't desire the things of God. So let me ask you. Why did you believe? Why? Why did you believe? Are you smarter than all the people that don't believe? I'm not. I can say I'm not, okay? I am definitely not smarter. Well, maybe I have more common sense than all the people that don't believe. I can't say that either. Well, maybe I have some internal quality about myself that caused me to believe. I can't really say that unless the internal quality is God. You see? John chapter 3 says the flesh is the flesh. He's telling Nicodemus, and this is very important. He's telling Nicodemus, you must be born again. Or you cannot see the kingdom of God, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. He's telling them that. See, the internal quality that I would possess is the Spirit of God. Because until I possess the Spirit of God, I'm flesh. I desire the world. And just like Scott was saying last week, when the Spirit of God resides in me and I still have this fleshly body, then I have this struggle. I have the flesh pulling me one way and the Spirit of God, who's stronger than my flesh, pulling me the other way. You see? But until I have the Spirit of God in me, I don't care what I'm doing. I don't care about certain sins. Now, don't get me wrong. The Spirit of God witnesses to people and they know. People know when they're sinning. And deep down, they care. But when the Spirit of God takes a hold of your life, now you really start to care and sin really starts to bother you. Then you try to conquer it on your own. Trust me, have y'all done this? You try to conquer it on your own and you can't conquer it. And you try and you try and you try and you can't conquer it until you turn it over to God. You have to get to that point where you say, you know what? I'm going to trust in Him. I can't trust in myself. I'm going to trust in Him. And that's the belief that we're talking about. That's the belief, is trusting in Jesus. See, you've added nothing to your salvation. See, there are some times where I don't like something God said. I don't know. You know, there ain't, now, honestly, I love it now. But there was times where I didn't. I was like, well, that can't be. That can't be right. Because that's a difficult doctrine. But then I think of Job. Like I was saying Wednesday night, I love Job. I love the book of Job. Job says this, chapter 40, verse 6 and 8. He says, the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, dress for action like a man. I will question you. Did you ever question God? Here's Job. Here's God telling Job, I'm going to question you. I'm tired of hearing your questions. Let me question you. He says, I will question you, and you make it known to me. My favorite chapters in the Bible. Will you even put me in the wrong? This is God. Will you condemn me that you may be in the right? Here's the problem. Why do some believe and others don't? The whole world is gone to hell. I don't understand it, but I'm not going to question it. But God saves. God saves. The Bible's clear. Whether you want to believe it or not, it's clear. God saves. He says, the ones that don't believe, Jesus flat out told them, the reason why you don't believe is because you're not of my flock. The whosoever. This is open to everyone. It is open to everyone. But the problem is we don't want it. God overcomes our hard hearts of stone and puts in that fleshly heart. He cleans us, he turns us around, and he brings us into his flock. It's God. The problem is the world doesn't want it. We have to pray for the world. We witness to the world, we pray for the world. Here's the thing. You plant the seed. You plant the seed. Who makes it grow? God. God makes it grow. Not you, but God. But we still plant the seed, which is the Word of God. So, Philippians chapter 2, verse 13 says, for it is God who works in you both to will and do and work for his good pleasure. Now, let's just sum this up. I'm going to read these last set of verses in John 3:18 and 19. It says, whoever believes in him, remember, John 3:16 is our balance beam. It's our what do they call it? Seesaw. Okay? It's in the middle of the fulcrum is in the middle of the chapter there. And it has the word for before it, and actually it continues on. A lot of people take John 3:16 and just read it. It says, John 3:18 and 19 says, whoever believes in him is not condemned. Okay? I'm not narrowing this field. I'm encouraging you today. If the Lord is pressing upon your heart to believe, then believe. Okay? Whoever believes in him is not condemned. But whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is a judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than light because their works were evil. Right there it says it. It says the world desires the darkness over the light. God overcomes that desire for the darkness. So if you want some steps for salvation, number one step that we have to do is we have to recognize that we are sinful. That we are not able to follow the law to the point that God requires it. We can't do it. It doesn't mean you don't try. Now, number two is you realize that one already did it for you. And that's Jesus Christ. That's Jesus Christ. And number three is you don't trust in yourself, you don't trust in your works, you don't trust in anything else. All you can trust in is what he's already done for you. That's all you can trust in is what he's already done for you. This thing about remaining, it says in his word, and we're going to get to it, that once you're in his hand, nothing will take you out of his hand. Nothing. Are you trusting in yourself to stay in His hand? Or are you trusting in Him to hold on to you? There's a big difference there. I always said this before. It's like a mom and a little girl crossing the street. Who do we trust in? The little girl to hold on to the mama's hand? Or the mama to hold on to the little girl's hand? The mama's the one that's going to hold on. She's not going to let that girl run out in traffic. Even though that little girl is crazy enough to run out in traffic. But the mama keeps her safe. Just like our Heavenly Father keeps us safe. You see? Trust in Him. Not in yourself, not in your works, and not in your ways. Repent from your sins and be baptized. Repent from your sins. See, once you understand that this is God has done it all, you will be happy and you will be jumping for joy because you were under this huge weight of sin. You were headed for the pit of hell, and then you realize that I don't have to go that way. I don't have to have these sins piled on me. Like Roy said, they're gone. What did you do to make them go away? You can't clean yourself enough. Jesus Christ did it. They're gone. This is good news. They're gone. But yet, some will probably twist it into bad news. But they're gone. Trust in Jesus. As we go forward, we're going to look at some of the other things where he says, the Son of Man must be raised like the serpent in the wilderness. We're going to go over that. There's some good stuff here in John chapter 3. Some important things. Because what if you go through your whole church life thinking it's your attendance, it's your offering, it's all the things you do for the church to save you. What if you go through your whole church life thinking that? You get to heaven and you find out that you're wrong. It's God that saves you, not yourself. So I'd rather be up front and have a few people get mad at me and tell you the truth than to tell you the way you want to hear it. So it's God that saves you. So as we sing this last song, let's just give Him glory and praise for